Joining us now in the studio, so we have Liz from the Mosaic Art Collective. And Liz, this is your third time on the show? Second, third?
I think this is my second time.
Second? Okay. Yep. All right. And you've got Hannah and Atlas with you, and they are first timers on the show.
Yes, they are.
I did meet Hannah at the last event, right? Last weekend, actually. It all becomes a blur. and I'm meeting Atlas for the first time. And you are the, I'm pretty sure you're the first individual named Atlas I've ever met.
I get that a lot, yeah.
So welcome to the show. Hannah, what is your involvement with Mosaic Art Collective?
I am one of the resident artists. Mosaic is, for those that don't know, is a gallery with a gallery hosted inside and four artist studios. So yeah. I'm lucky enough to be one of the four. And I'm also the secretary of the Mosaic Art Collective Board.
Okay. And Atlas, how about you?
Yeah, I'm one of the members.
Pull that sure, mic over, yeah. Right in front. Yeah, you got to be right on it.
I'm the head of PR for Mosaic, and I've been with them since June.
Lean over a little bit, so you're like, you got to talk right.
All good.
It. Yeah, that's the worst mic in the room.
It's okay, no worries.
In the room, unfortunately.
Yeah, so I'm now head of PR for Mosaic. And
okay.
I've been with Mosaic since June, and I've just been trying to be a part of it every way I can. It's been an awesome ride so far. Yeah.
Yeah, excellent. Well, congratulations. Very good.
I appreciate it.
So Liz, how's it been for you? I mean, this has really grown, right? I was commenting to Hannah that earlier off air that. That was quite the turnout last Saturday.
Unfortunately, I wasn't at the opening.
Oh, that's right. Yeah, yeah.
But I have heard it was a fabulous turnout. We've had a couple of slower months, I think. In general, there was a lot going on in the art world, so probably less people were available. And I think, luckily, this time around, there were a number of people that were available. But also, it's a larger show because it's... I don't remember exactly how many artists we have. It's over 60 okay. artists in the show. When that happens, you end up with a pretty good turnout.
So yeah, yeah.
All the pieces that are up on the wall right now are small works. So they're mm-hmm. all more affordable, really great gift giving sizes and prices. And so we're really lucky.
When you do something like where the theme is smaller, I mean, did you put a size limit on that? Like they couldn't be
yep.
larger than certain dimensions?
Yep. So the dimensions are smaller than 12 by 12 inches.
Okay.
And that's in any direction. So, because we do have some sculptural pieces as well.
When you do something like that, do you find that you get a different... submissions from people who may not have submitted before? Do you see a lot of new names?
Sometimes. I think in the last several months, we've seen an uptick in new artists, which is really cool because I think around June, I started feeling like maybe we've tapped into all the artists in the area and this is the amount of artists that we have.
Yeah.
And then really in the last 3 months or so, we've seen a huge... number of new artists showing up for open calls. So I don't know that it's changed necessarily because of the sizes or if it's just that more people are finding out about us. And
yeah.
I would argue artists love a good challenge.
Yes.
So anything yeah. more restrictive in terms of theme or anything like that, it really, as me personally as an artist, like I find that very helpful,
yeah,
because I can put more into it knowing exactly what I'm looking for.
Right.
So I think the 12 by 12 sort of it's like more of like a challenge to try to make something beautiful out of something within that space. And,
right.
I think people responded really well to that.
Yeah.
And
yeah.
Atlas actually took the challenge in a totally different direction, and he has a really cool piece in the show where he painted on a knife.
Oh, really?
Okay. That's definitely worth checking out if you want to stop into the gallery or go online and look at our online gallery.
But, okay.
Yeah.
Was that difficult, Atlas?
Yeah, it was a totally different canvas to paint on. It's
yeah.
not something that you would expect to have trouble with, but it was quite quite difficult. But I had so much fun doing something within that brand new medium.
And yeah.
It was obviously inspired by the Mosaic Small Wonders show.
And okay.
I was like, this seems like the perfect opportunity to try something new.
Right.
Put something new into it. And yeah, it was great. And it came out with an awesome result. And I'm so happy that I was able to do that.
Yeah. Yeah. Excellent. Excellent. Now when people submit, you know, you call it a juried, what's the right term?
A juried show.
Like who chooses, like, obviously Liz, you're part of that process, but, are you also both, Hannah and Atlas, are you both, involved in that well in terms of choosing who gets in? And
it's a collaborative effort. It's usually about 3 to 4 people that are selecting the work, and then we get together as a group several days after the work comes in, and we collaborate once again and make decisions on how to arrange the show so that it's harmonious and each piece that is situated in a way where it really shines next to the other work. So it's a really interesting process, not only choosing the work that is selected, but also how do you arrange such a diverse arrangement of such selected works?
Yeah, yeah. Has the number of selections, or I should say, I'm sorry, the number of submissions, has that really kind of increased over time? Because I would imagine, like the first show that you did there,
mm-hmm.
I would imagine that was a significantly less number because it was the first show, or maybe not. Maybe there's such a need and demand for what you're doing. Maybe you had a lot right out of the gate. I don't know.
I mean, the first show was interesting because I had never done anything like this before, and really it was just a complete guess to see what would happen. I did end up reaching out to another one of the residents at Mosaic who has a strong connection with a number of local artists, and told her that we hadn't gotten the numbers that I had hoped.
Yeah.
And I had to extend the deadline. And I said, can you share this with your audience? And she did. And that brought in some more people. So we did end up at the very first show, I think we had 40 or so artists. The work was a really interesting range of emerging to professional artists.
Mm-hmm.
And I think from month to month, it kind of ebbs and flows. Like, I truly get freaked out about a week before the deadline, because most artists wait till the very last minute to submit their work. And I usually, like, the week before will start, like, if I really notice that we haven't had any submissions, I'll start, like, tapping people and being like, hey, are you planning on submitting your work?
Right.
And, you know, chances are some of them are, or some of them are just too busy that month. But yeah, it kind of, it changes.
Mm-hmm.
So.
Yeah.
Yeah.
No, that makes sense.
Yeah.
The Small Wonders, that's actually running for 2 months. Is that correct?
It is.
Okay.
So this, we have historically done a small work show in November and December. Part of that is self-preservation because we're getting into like the busy holiday season.
Mm-hmm.
And I, at the beginning, just couldn't take setting up another show in December.
Yeah.
But also I think it offers more time for people to shop and see the show. We'll have another opening the second Saturday of December for Amy, who runs the Seesaw Gallery. She'll have a what's the name of her show? Do you remember? Presently, I think is what her show is called. That's another open call, and she'll have an opening that night as well. And we're hoping that there'll be another good turnout. And then I think we're also planning on doing a closing on December 22nd. So, we try to like keep, you know, movement in the gallery, get people in. And, as of right now, we had been doing, almost month to month shows. And I think going forward after November and December, we're planning on doing, bi-monthly shows instead.
Okay.
We needed a little more time. I think all of us, just from an organizational standpoint, needed more time to rest and then also be able to bring in some workshops and stuff like that. We'd really like to do more community outreach. And it's hard when you're either setting up or taking down a show within like a week or two of each other. So we're hoping with the extended shows that we'll have some more time to do that kind of stuff.
Yeah, no, that, that makes sense.
And it also gives artists the opportunity to bring in more of their friends and family. Yeah. Mm-hmm. A month is a really tight turnaround. So yeah, that'd be a great opportunity.
Yeah, yeah, no, that makes sense. Yeah, I remember Jenny and I attended an event that you had had about, I don't remember the gentleman's name, forgive me, but about AI in art.
Yeah.
That was really interesting.
Yeah, he, that's Carl. So he was fast. This, it's interesting because like AI has just exploded now. So,
yeah.
But at the time it was like this fairly new thing that was sort of like freaking all the artists out. And I think because of his background, he comes from a tech background. He called his job an ethical hacker for IBM. So he would look for the weak points in the system and try to break it so that he could learn how to fix it.
Yeah.
So he did a ton of research on AI and brought that workshop to us, which was super awesome.
Yeah.
And we would like to offer more of that kind of stuff. I know we were in talks with Karen Jerzik, who's an installation artist. She is not an AI artist at all. And she gets called that a lot. She's a photographer.
Why does she get called an AI artist?
Her artwork is pretty surreal.
Okay.
Sorry.
It's okay.
her artwork is surreal. So it has a vibe that kind of lends itself to looking like it's computer generated.
That's interesting to me.
Yeah.
Yeah.
But she actually doesn't even use like Photoshop all that much.
Yeah.
Which most photographers these days, I would say, at least use a little bit of touch up.
Sure.
At points in their process.
Kind of a staple for a lot of photographers, yeah.
Yeah. But she does not. And she's actually had a lot of success with, what are they called? NFTs and stuff.
Yeah, yeah.
So we're hoping to get her in and have her do an artist talk and sort of talk a bit more about that.
That's interesting to me. You know, the subject of AI comes up a lot on the show. And it's interesting, you know, because we talk about people looking at art and not knowing or any kind of image and not knowing whether it's real or AI generated. And we worry about people looking at things and assuming that they're not AI generated when actually they are. But her artwork, you say, like people accuse her of using AI and she's actually not. That's interesting. So the inverse can also be a pitfall.
Yeah.
I wouldn't have expected that. Wow. Yeah. That's fascinating.
Yeah, definitely somebody to check out.
Yeah, yeah. What was her name again?
Karen Jerzik. She's right in Manchester too.
So. Okay, okay. Yeah. Wow. Yeah. Do you do any kind of classes there, or do you have plans to in the future for people who think they might have some ability but want to kind of expand on it?
I don't know that we're looking to do. I mean, maybe. Maybe at some point.
Yeah.
I think once we get our heads wrapped around the scheduling and have a little bit more time to think about what kinds of programs we're looking for, what kinds of classes would really benefit the community the most.
Yeah.
And just seeing what people are interested in.
Right, right.
We have done some like workshop style classes. Jackie Hansen did an eraser printmaking workshop. A couple times we had somebody do a terrarium building workshop. I think there was actually a WordPress workshop at some point.
Really?
Yeah.
What on how to build a WordPress site?
How to build a website.
Oh, okay.
It was interesting because it was attended by artists and then who don't use WordPress.
Yeah.
And, myself who uses nothing. And my husband, who is a web developer and uses WordPress all the time.
Yeah.
So it, you know, WordPress is really hard to use. That's what I've come to learn. So it's not the most like artist friendly.
Still helpful
development.
Absolutely. Still helpful. Yeah.
Yeah.
Anything we can offer, really.
Yeah. 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 No, that makes sense.
Yeah.
That makes sense. When did Mosaic first open? It's been at least, what, has it been 2 years? Has it been longer?
It's been, so 2.5-ish. I mean, I think we opened in September of 2022.
Okay.
And after a year of being an LLC, we transitioned to a nonprofit model.
Okay.
And then we've been a nonprofit for just over a year.
Okay.
So yeah.
What was that always the goal, to become a nonprofit? Or
I think for me, when I was originally dreaming up Mosaic, I mean, I was really young. Mosaic was something I wanted to do when I was like fresh out of college. I graduated and was just lacking art community and couldn't figure out where I belonged.
Yeah.
So in some ways, I think I didn't really know what it would totally look like. And once I started doing it, it just became like a larger thing than I could do by myself.
Mm-hmm.
And the community aspect of it was so important that I felt like I was already reaching out to people and asking their advice or asking how to do something.
Yeah.
So the nonprofit just sort of like naturally made sense.
Right.
So I don't know that it was like necessarily like the thing I thought would happen, but it made sense when we went in that direction.
Yeah. Yeah. Of course. Are you, you're not from Manchester originally, correct?
I actually am from Hooksett.
Okay. Yeah.
I went to Central.
Okay.
Yeah. So I grew up here.
Oh, you did. Okay. Yeah. Okay. Did you move away at one point and move back?
I did.
Maybe that's what I'm thinking of. Yeah.
Yeah. Okay. Yeah, I lived, so I went to art school down in Baltimore, Maryland.
Okay.
And then after Baltimore, moved back here for a very brief time, and then up to Vermont, and then I lived in Burlington, Vermont for 15-ish years.
Oh, okay.
And then moved back during the pandemic.
So, gotcha.
Yeah.
Burlington's got not a bad little music scene there.
It has a fabulous music scene.
There's some good bands up there that kind of, you know, that a lot of people around here might not know about, because Burlington, it seems like it's so far, but it's really not. I mean, no. How far is it?
2.5 hours.
2.5. That's what I was thinking. Yeah.
Yeah.
Yeah. Yeah. There's some cool place. Is Higher Ground still there?
Oh yes.
Yeah.
Yeah.
Yeah. That's a cool venue.
Yep.
I haven't been there in a very, very long time.
We should take a field trip.
Yeah. Yeah. Yeah, it's a cool place. Not in the winter, though.
No.
We'll do that.
Well, I love it.
In the summer. Yeah, if you are just joining us, we have Liz, Hannah, and Atlas from the Mosaic Art Collective here with us live in studio on this Saturday morning. Do you work with other studios as well? Like, do you have these relationships where you kind of, I don't know, because you did refer to, is it Seesaw?
Seesaw Art on Hanover. Yes.
Okay.
So Seesaw is sort of similar to Hannah. You want to explain it? Like, they also rent space in the gallery or in the studio.
Okay.
And rent, rather than utilizing it as a studio, they use it as a gallery.
Okay.
So Amy Regan, who runs Seesaw, is also one of the founders from the Rochester Museum of Fine Art.
Okay.
And she runs sort of like a boutique style gallery. So it's usually like 2 to 3 artists from the region.
Okay.
And yeah. But we also have worked with NHAA. We've worked with Queer Elective. We've worked with
the Women's Caucus.
The Women's Caucus for the Arts. This year, we kind of took a slower role on partnering just to see, like, get our feet wet and see what it was like to be a nonprofit.
Right.
But I'd like to do some more partnerships.
Yeah.
Going forward.
Yeah.
And speaking of partnerships, many months at the gallery, we choose a cause to support.
Oh, okay.
And this month we are gathering art supplies for the Webster House.
Okay.
Webster. No,
we did Webster House last year.
Okay.
This year we're hoping to donate to Waypoint, but we haven't heard back.
Oh, okay. So that's kind of still up in the air.
That's okay. And we're also having a weekly raffle of all sorts of community restaurants, artists, and other prizes and things like that to benefit
the Reproductive Freedom Fund of New Hampshire.
Okay.
We're just wanting to do whatever we can to help out our community right now.
Right.
And I think that's a good way to do it.
Yeah, yeah. No, I think that's great.
Yeah.
I seem to remember I think maybe the last time you were on you might have talked about Webster House.
Yep.
Are you trying to do something different each time, like to help a different organization or?
Yeah, I think I just wanted, I think we were hoping to like spread the love around.
Yeah, yeah.
As much as possible.
It's kind of nice. It's a way where we can say, hey, we're seeing you do some great work and mm-hmm. we'd like to benefit you.
Yeah,
so.
Yeah.
And I think, you know, as far as like the donation, like the art donation, the supply donations, for a lot of us, growing up, art was incredibly important in our lives.
Mm-hmm.
We recognize like the need for kids to have access to art supplies, and there are a lot of kids who don't.
Right.
And it doesn't seem like the immediate need, but I think to express yourself definitely helps make situations feel less overwhelming.
Sure. Yeah. Yeah. Well, you know, something that we talk about a lot on the show, and it's we talk to a lot of musicians, so it tends to be more in that modality. But we talk about, and I was talking about it with Dennis actually from the Gray Curtain during the first hour a little bit too, the event that he's doing tonight in Connecticut. We were talking about taking traumatic events or taking problems that you have, or you know, mental illness or whatever it may be, and any time that you can create something from that, you know, take it, but create something, create art, create, whether it's visual art or music or whatever it is, or write a book or, you know, that to me, that's the best therapy, right?
Yeah.
When you can take something negative and do something creative and productive with it. Mm-hmm. And I assume now I have no, you know, I'm a musician, but I have no, ability whatsoever for visual art. I can't paint or anything like that.
That's
so
not true.
So I'm kind of in awe. No, trust me, it is. But but I assume a lot of visual artists, you know, they put that into their paintings, I would imagine, you know, mm-hmm. that as an expression of that pain and that trauma. And stand-up comedians are really kind of famous for that. Like any stand-up comedian you talk to, it's like they've had like major trauma, and the way that they deal with it is learning how to make people laugh, whether they're actually making jokes based on what they've been through or not. But yeah. that's their therapy. You know, stand-up comedians are almost always, you know, like just messed up people in some way. Mm-hmm. You know what I mean? But I think that's so important. And you know, you mentioned too developing that in kids. Is that something that is lacking in our schools, do you think? I mean, I remember, you know, I went to a private school from grade 2 to grade 8, and we had art class, and that was where I learned that I have no visual visual ability art-wise. I have no artistic ability in that sense. but do you think that's something that's lacking? Is that something that where parents need to really kind of encourage that and foster that? Because I don't know. I don't know if our schools are doing that at all or not.
I'm a public school teacher
art
teacher.
Oh, so you? Oh, okay, great.
And I know that, or at least I believe that New Hampshire public schools are required to offer art and music.
Okay.
Kindergarten through high school.
Oh, good. So, okay, I didn't know that. So they're required by law to do that?
Yeah.
Oh, that's excellent. Okay, I didn't know that.
However, with different towns receiving different funding, mm-hmm. some programs don't have as much to offer as other towns. That are better off.
Yeah, because I know that, you know, these school budgets tend to be tight, and it seems like when you hear about budget cuts in public school, it's usually, you know, the sports are protected and everything else kind of is on that second tier where they think, oh, maybe we can get rid of this, we can get rid of that. But you, so you work in public schools and you're an art teacher. So you're proof of concept that this is still happening in New Hampshire, that where we have the arts being taught. So
very much so. So New Hampshire good. Has one of the strongest art programs, I'd say, in the country.
Oh, that's
Scholastic
great.
Art Awards, which is the largest and most prestigious high school art show in New Hampshire.
Oh, wow.
We're number two in terms of the size and scale of next, right behind New Jersey.
No kidding.
So, and it's all volunteer.
Oh,
all
that's great.
So
that's great. Yeah. Yeah. Makes me proud to be a New Hampshireite. Oh, that's really good. I had no idea.
Yep. I mean, I think in general, I have three kids in the school system. I think in general, they have had a phenomenal arts education, but also, I mean, school is what you put into it too. Mm-hmm.
Yeah.
And if the parents aren't willing to foster a love of art or culture, they're only going to get what they get at school.
Right. Right.
So I feel like, you know, especially looking at my kids now go to the schools that I went to as a kid.
Mm-hmm.
And one of the teachers is one of my teachers.
Yeah.
So she's been there forever. And I think, like, in terms of, I think, you know, she's doing a good job. I think the younger teachers that are coming through, no, you're young.
But, not that young.
Yeah, but I know you've been teaching a long time. But I like Hannah does a great job.
Yeah.
But I think you know, the younger teachers that are coming through have a different concept of how to teach art. And I think that can be kind of interesting to watch. I think they are not too long ago when I was teaching, there was this method called teaching for artistic behavior, which is more of a choice-based learning. And I think that
what does that mean, choice-based learning?
So it's not like, here's a picture of a snowman and this is how you make this picture of a snowman.
Okay.
It's more like, here are the materials that you might need. This is what I did. How you do it.
Okay.
That everyone sees differently and everyone's going to create a little bit differently. And
intuitively, that makes more sense to me.
It does.
Yeah.
And I feel like it offers students a chance to delve into the arts where they are most interested. Because some kids aren't really interested in getting their hands dirty.
Right.
But they are really interested in puzzles and building and that kind of thing. And so I think, you know, offering as much as we can to our kids is really what it's all about. And mm-hmm. I think in New Hampshire, they are doing a pretty bang up job.
So. Yeah. Yeah. No, yeah. Sounds like it. Yeah. Sounds like it. Yeah. Do you have students submit? Like, do you have like high school students and...
Yep.
And younger submitting to?
We do. One of my favorite submissions for this last show is was a mother and son. Her son builds these Lego worlds.
Okay.
And she photographs them.
Oh.
And so she's new to the area and found out about this call and submitted one of the photographs of her son's Lego build and was just so excited to bring him to the gallery and share that with him and, you know, to be embraced. So that was really cool.
That's very cool.
Yeah. And we also at Mosaic, we have an art intern who comes in and he submits quite a few pieces to the different shows as well.
Okay.
In addition, last year there was a show To Manchester Would Love, which featured works from all of the Manchester public high schools. So it was an opening dedicated just to the students and their teachers. And that was really, really cool.
Yeah. Oh, wow. Oh, very good. Very good. Are there more, because I feel like, you know, as you're talking about these different places that are involved in art, are there more, Is there more of an art scene than people realize, I guess, is what I'm asking? Because I feel like, you know, as you're mentioning, you know, different, like you mentioned Seesaw and these other places, I wonder if, and I guess Atlas, this is part of where you come in, right? Making sure that people know that there is all this, you know, like, because I didn't even realize sitting here, you know, I'm asking you about, you know, do they even teach art in schools anymore? I had no idea that New Hampshire is doing such a great job with that. Is there more of an art scene than people know about?
Yeah, absolutely. I'd say that, like, in the past 2 years, it's really blossomed quite a bit. And just receiving the network of knowing about the art has gotten a lot more prominent, I would say. As somebody who's fairly new to the whole art scene in Manchester,
It
definitely feels like it's blossomed in the past 2 years.
Yeah.
Sure. Absolutely.
Oh, that's great.
And
yeah.
It's awesome to see the festivals that are out there, all the events that are going on. And Mosaic being part of that.
Yeah.
Absolutely. Yeah.
Yeah. Oh, that's great. That's great. That's really good to hear.
Ultimately, I think the art scene has been here all along. I think that it's just sort of more out in the open now.
Mm-hmm.
I would agree.
Yeah.
It's morphed a lot. I feel with the closing of traditional galleries, there's more room for alternative spaces and people are getting really creative and open-minded. Places that come to mind are like Pillar Art Project, where they have a small gallery front up in Concord with a ghost kitchen in back. And Outer Space Gallery, which is hosted on the second floor of a Victorian office building.
Oh, wow.
So, I mean, there's these pockets that are opening up and people are getting much more creative. And it's less about profit and more about community and getting the artwork out there.
Okay. Okay. That makes sense. Why have you referenced traditional art or art galleries, rather? I want to make sure I use the right term, closing. Why is that? Why is this? It sounds like there's been a shift in that sense.
Yeah, there has been a shift. Some of the shift is a lot of art has gone online. Rents have gone up. It is difficult to sustain a gallery model where, you know, you're relying on foot traffic and, you know, whether or not your audience is going to be receptive to the work, whether or not they have the means to purchase the work. A lot of places, especially when COVID hit, had to close their doors.
Yep. That makes sense. So it sounds like the traditional gallery model is more just you have, it's almost, you know, like a retail store in a sense, right? You've got art just hanging and people walk in. You hope somebody walks in and buys something. So it sounds like there's been a need, especially after the pandemic, to be more creative with how you do things. And like you're very creative with how you're doing things at Mosaic. And, you've got all these things going on. So that makes sense.
I would say, like, in the wake of tragedy, like in terms of the COVID pandemic, a lot of people who are around community organization tend to be like, okay, this is the time to dig in and roll up our sleeves.
Yeah.
This is what we need to do for the people in our community because they really, really need it.
Yeah.
And I would say that it's definitely evident in the wake of a pandemic that really rocked everybody.
Yeah.
Especially people in places of need.
Mm-hmm.
Seeing that come from that.
Right.
It was so apparent. And it's very lifting and it's very enlightening. It's wonderful to be a part of it.
Yeah.
For sure. Absolutely.
Yeah. Well, something I always say too about the pandemic is as awful as it was for so many reasons, we also have to try to find those silver linings where we can, you know, speaking of dealing with trauma, right? And something that this also comes up a lot on the show is it kind of forced people to be more creative in ways that maybe they hadn't considered before. You know, you see it a lot with me, you know, like during, you know, when everybody was staying home, for example, with music, you saw a lot of these bands, you know, doing live performances where they're all, you know, they're all connected on Zoom and they're doing these live performances online, things like that. But it affected everyone. And obviously, you know, it affected visual art. And I think it sounds like it did kind of force people to be more creative with that as well. And how they, how they show the art to the world and all of that. What's kind of the what's kind of the future trajectory for Mosaic? I mean, you talked about some of it, but is there anything you have planned that we didn't mention that we should know about? Or
We do have a new show going up in January. It will be one of our another two month shows.
Okay.
And I can't recall what the name of it is.
Yeah,
it's still workshopping it. It's all good.
Yeah. But the show itself is op art, so optical illusions and black light art.
Oh, cool.
Sort of like, I think kind of like Creatures of the Night sort of a thing. We figure with the darkness happening at like 4 o'clock, yes, we're going to take advantage of the darkness outside and bring it inside and let the gallery, the artwork kind of illuminate the space.
Oh, that's cool. Yeah. I like that concept.
Yeah.
Boy, talk about taking something negative and creating something with it. I hate it when it's dark at 4 p.m. Oh, I dread it. Does anyone like it, really?
I don't think so.
I don't think even people, because some people are weird and they actually enjoy winter. No offense if any of you are like that. Personally, I think enjoying winter is very strange. But I've never heard anyone say, yeah, I like it when it's dark at 4 p.m. That I've never heard.
No.
No.
I feel like every single day it's like, is it really dark this soon?
Yeah.
Again?
Yeah. You don't really get used to it. It's, no. You're right. Yeah. Like so every day it's like, oh, it's dark again at 4 p.m.
Yeah.
It's not great. It's not great. Well, listen, thank you all for coming in. This has been wonderful. And, what should people know about, you should probably mention the website and anything else people should know about what's happening at Mosaic right now. And of course, how they can submit for a future show.
So visit our website. That usually has up-to-date information, mosaicartcollective.com. We're also on Instagram under Mosaic Art Collective. And any of the open calls are always listed on our website and on Instagram. And then we also have a mailing list that you can sign up for on our website, and that will also send out the calls for art.
So, okay.
Yeah.
All right. Perfect. Perfect. Yeah. And congratulations again on last weekend. It looked like a really good, I know you weren't able to be there, Liz, but it looked like it was very successful. And, Jenny is so proud to have, multiple pieces hanging there. And it's just, she hasn't, I don't think she'll mind me saying this, she hasn't been an artist for that long in the grand scheme of things. I mean, it's been maybe 5 years since she first picked up a brush and said, I think I want to try this. And I'm just, like I said, as someone who doesn't have that ability, I'm just amazed at how much she creates and how amazing it is. And, I'm just in awe. She's got her artwork hanging at home, of course, too. And so I see it every day, but I'm just, every new piece she creates, it's like, wow. Like, how do you even do that? it's just amazing to me, and to see how far that she's come with it,
Yeah. And a lot of the artists at Mosaic are fairly, I'd say some are fairly new.
A lot of artists that we are the first venue where they show. And, I remember the first show that I was in and what an exciting event it was and how cool it was to be up on the wall with all these other artists. And at the same time, we have artists that show nationally. So it's a really, really great range of different artists, art styles, and everyone is welcome.
Yeah. Mm-hmm. Yeah. Oh, that's fantastic. All right. Well, Liz, Hannah, Atlas, thank you all so much.
Thank you.
And
thank you.
We'll do this again soon, I'm sure.